instructional coach. I wanted to tell my story about grammar because I know that a lot of us, especially in the K-2 setting, come in with some nerves when it comes to grammar. I was raised in New Jersey, and the education that I received there did not include much grammar. I never did diagramming. I rarely talked about the parts of speech. I knew nouns and verbs, but that was it. All the way through college and my master's, never learned about grammar. Came to Arizona, started teaching first grade, and found out that I was teaching grammar. And, you know, as a lifelong learner, I really didn't feel like I needed to educate myself in this field because I was teaching a very surfacey level of grammar, and I knew that I needed to know more to present it to my students. So as a network, Great Hearts has been working to shape grammar and understand it more. And for the past 2 years, Maryvale Prep has been using First Language Lessons by Susan Wise Bauer. And that was the first step towards my education of grammar. And then this summer, I took a course through Great Hearts on sentence diagramming and understanding grammar. And so, you know, I know I'm supposed to say I'm an expert in grammar, but I would say I'm getting there. And I would just love to have a conversation with you about grammar, and hopefully we can all just walk away from it, you know, feeling better about when we teach grammar tomorrow or on Monday. So I would love to just go around the room, just names, school, and your experience with grammar. Do you love it and you diagram every night before you go to bed? Or, you know, is this, I know my nouns and my verbs and that's pretty much it. So I shared my story. Would you like to start? Okay.
I'm an assistant to the special ed teacher, and I like grammar. I forced it down my children's throats when I homeschooled because we lived overseas.
Yeah.
Okay.
So now we know.
I'm Tammy Towers, and I'm teaching in first grade, and I'm helping the lead teacher, helping the assistant. And my experience with grammar is I was pretty good at it in school, but there's a lot to be learned. That's why I'm here. I'm Leslie Ellison, and I'm a first grade teacher. And I know my friends are special, but I've never done it.
Black, and I'm kindergarten, Archway Arite, and I like math better than I liked grammar, but that's why I'm here, because I
like
having
weakness. I'm Zach, I teach second grade at Archway at Chandler, and dust up, and I just got my seventh tiger.
Okay. I'm Allison, also from Archway Chandler. I've had more experience doing grammar and foreign language study, so now look at it from an English perspective.
I'm Quinn Mitchell. I am acting lead for a kindergarten here at Veritas, and my play lead is currently on maternity leave, so I'm going to change that and resume my teenage days. I love diagramming. I'm really excited. I'm so excited that we're doing diagramming things.
Great.
Like when
yeah.
And I don't get to do kindergarten.
Really exciting.
I'm Grace Fawcett, teaching assistant in grade at Archway Chandler. Mm-hmm. The last one I said since diagram was in sixth grade.
It's pretty good. I can see it from here.
Thanks. So, I mean, I'm okay, but I'm not. Okay.
Sure.
I'm Michelle Chardinsky. I teach kindergarten at Archway Veritas. And I've had much experience with it lately. The past few years. I like it, though I'm interested in it, and I'm interested in how to teach it better. I'd like to do a better job even with kindergarten. So.
Yeah.
I'm Justin Lee, I'm a TA here at Archway Veritas. I had a really good grammar teacher in fifth through eighth grade, but I haven't done much yet.
Okay.
I'm Wendy Lowe, I'm also here at Archway Veritas. And
grammar's, I'm here because I want to learn how to teach grammar.
Sheena Rowland, first grade here at Archway Veritas. I feel comfortable with parts of speech, but I have never diagrammed.
Great. In the back.
an interloper. I'm from an upper grade, but I've got some lower level students, and so I actually would like to get stronger in the foundations.
Wonderful.
So, and that's why I'm here.
Up in the front.
I'm Paul Zamola. I teach at Talios Preparatory, first grade. I'm an assistant teacher. I'm an assistant up in the preparatory level, 6th, 7th, and 8th history. And I'm good with English, but I'm not a major.
Max DeMette, I'm in Talios as well. I'm a second grade assistant. Never diagrammed before, but I did get my degree in English, so I can look at your paper and tell you that you have a really passive language and how to fix it. So.
Great.
Okay, but I think I'm a nice student. I'm at Talios. Mm-hmm. It's about Williams, teacher in the garden. I'm also really good at grammar, but I didn't learn it by diagramming. So I can write well, and I can edit well, but I don't know the stuff together.
Great.
Sure. Yeah, I'm Catherine Laundrie. I'm a second grade teacher at Archway Chandler. And yeah, I'm comfortable with parts of speech, but I'm doing a diagram as well.
I'm a second grade teacher at Talios. And quickly, my objective this year is making sure nobody uses preposition in the season. So I'll leave it that.
I love that goal.
No ads.
I'm Jamie with Quadec, and I teach at Cicero First Grade. And I also don't remember learning a lot of grammar growing up, but I homeschooled and taught for a number of years.
I'm Alex Patterson, second grade TA. My dad's kind of a grammar Nazi, but I've never done diagramming.
Go ahead.
Jennifer Minson, here at Veritas, second grade TA. Love grammar, grew up in New Jersey, did learn grammar. Love diagramming.
Rose Moore, grade three, second grade, DA, and I feel like I haven't been diagramming since the Pirates. So I'm very interested. I've seen my kids do it, but, you know,
I'm Chanel Lagarde. I'm a second grade lead over at Archway Cicero, and other than the parts of speech, I learned to diagram with my second grader.
I'm Laura Milford, Archway Cicero. I'm comfortable with parts of speech.
Archway Scottsdale, my name is Susie Turner, second grade assistant, and I grew up diagramming a different way than our program, but I enjoy it because everything's got its place. It's kind of like math. You kind of look at it like a puzzle and you kind of fit everything together. So I think it's fun.
I'm Philip Escondon, assistant teacher, first grade Archway Cicero. What was the second question?
Your experience with grammar. I said, do you do it before you go to bed at night, or is it new?
I have kind of very sundry experience with grammar. I studied parts of speech and some diagramming in high school. Mm-hmm. And then in college actually, but hasn't been somewhat extensive.
Also, would you like a chair?
Nice.
Okay. One of our teachers here just ran to grab one.
Okay, we also have four. I know we have four more from my school that will be here.
Okay, I can grab
them. Yeah, you don't mind.
Yeah, I've got some of my.
I can sign
you.
Sorry, we can finish up.
Okay. Okay, my name is Tammy Pratt. I'm at Archway Chandler, and I teach kindergarten and I can teach in first grade. I like grammar, but and I diagram my own model except for K-1-2 classes at Archway. Mm-hmm. But I attended the system class hours.
Absolutely. Thank you.
I'm Leslie Santana, Archway Chandler, teaching assistant, and my experience with grammar has been a while, so I'm Cheryl.
Welcome. Ashley Atkinson, Archway Chandler. Good with parts of speech, but diagramming with the
debating how to present, like, why study grammar, right? We know it's interesting for kids to look at a sentence and take it apart and know its parts. It enhances their writing if they know how to build on a sentence. And then I kind of took a step back and I was thinking, grammar is essentially the language we use to explain our existence. Everything we say is either a preposition, where you're placing things, where your body is, where others are. And I think that that can kind of ground our study today, and just thinking about how truly important grammar is, especially for our kindergarteners through second graders, when they are beginning those foundational steps into grammar. So the other thing I wanted to tell you was they only told me 20 people would be here, so I made 30 copies, but there's more than 30 people in here. So if you, or if you have a buddy that you love and you're sitting next to and you guys want to do it together, or, yeah,
there's a lot of worksheets that I have, but we can start with that.
Senses. So could you think of something that maybe you could touch that would be a noun?
desk is the first one I have on my list. I'm not kidding.
Great job.
Something you could smell?
Flower.
Flower. And we could do river. So abstract nouns cannot be identified with the senses. Anybody name an abstract noun?
Integrity.
Great job. Another one? Come
on.
There's cheats right there.
Courage.
Courage.
Perseverance. And we can add love. Anybody? Groups of people?
Teens and family.
Yeah. Army, children, audience. From Arizona State, and she was like, how do the kids always know when to say something back to you? And I was like, because you just like,
they know.
And they know when it comes, so you did it. And so I've been thinking about, how do they know when to say it? So demonstrative pronouns. Anybody? Take the place of an object. So is that yours? So that would be the pronoun. We have this, that, these, those. Interrogative. I underline the part interrogate. It comes from interrogate. So it asks a question, who, whose, whom. Personal pronouns, so points of view. I and me is what point of view?
First
person. You. He, she. We also have possessive pronouns that show ownership, mine, yours, his, hers. Indefinite, where you do not know the amount, so several, few, everyone. I put this example in here. I don't know how many of you will come across this in your life, but it helped me that, you know, if several are coming up the stairs, but if you say several boys, several is now explaining boys. It's telling you, it's explaining the word boys. So it has to be the actual pronoun. Relative pronouns, so they relate to another noun in the sentence. So the girl who lived next door. So who is
being explained by the girl. And so that, the pronouns also make up the word differ.
Spelled wrong, I know, but it's just differ.
Okay, turn the page. So state in action or state of being? Oh, I didn't fill in one on interrogative. Which and where? I know that you were just dying about it. So verb states an action or a state of being. So there's two types of verbs. Something we can see, such as jumping and walking. How about something you cannot see? We can have two words to explain those two different types. Right?
Yeah,
right. Right. So you're there. So there's mental, and then there's also physical.
Why do you say state of an action rather than action? Because the word state would seem to suggest it's something a little more static, you know.
Do you know what I think I forgot? Was an S. States in action.
Well, I'm just saying, like, why do you say states in action?
Right. So the word job would be stating the action in the sentence.
Oh, stating.
States.
Oh, states. Okay. Yeah. I thought, okay.
That actually was a fill in the blank, if you could just put an S
right in there. And it was one of my philosophical questions.
Yeah. I was hoping you'd catch it. I am not going to go over the types of verbs. You have all fall break if you want to dive back into this. It was helpful for me just to build my knowledge of verbs. We'll move down to adjectives. Someone's best definition of an adjective.
Describes.
Yeah. Describes, and also an important word is modifies. Describes and modifies. A noun or a pronoun. So what you'll see throughout the document, I should also point out, is this is from the course that I took over this summer. It was a week-long course. And so I do have just notes that were given to me, such as this one that's like, help your students memorize these questions that don't necessarily follow the trend of some of the other parts of speech, but I chose to include them. We also have article adjectives. I kept that in there, a, and the. A and an are indefinite, so you say a apple or an apple, and you wouldn't know which one I was talking about, but if I said the apple, you would know which one. Modifies verbs or adjectives. Part of speech is conjunctions. join two or more words, phrases, or classes together. You can also just put conjoin. Subordinating, begin subordinate adverb clauses. Colleen Posner, who's teaching the course, said that this is how our students remember it. Alubis, after, although as my last, because before it makes sense. The next part of speech that connects a noun or a pronoun to another word. Showing some relationship. Preposition. They also begin prepositional phrases. And then the word here is phrase. Prepositional phrase is a group of words that begins with a preposition and ends in a noun or pronoun. So on the couch. It is connecting the couch to the cat. So if it was like the cat sat on the couch. And the last part of speech. Yeah, you have to say it like an interjection. Yeah. Alas! An interjection. Okay, so I left this one open because this is, interjections are really fun and I knew you could fill it up with all the wonderful things you could say before a sentence, such as, wow, alas. Anything else that you want to yell out? All right.
That's Zeus.
Great. So it comes before the sentence. Wow! You look beautiful today. Alas. It is not connected to the sentence. Great.
I like the Lego metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
I can see that working really well.
Thank you. I cannot take credit though, it was college. Okay. So I also did make copies of the first, yes,
sorry, can I ask a question?
Yes,
back on pronouns, the interactive program pronouns. I was wondering, can you explain where? How that fits with the interactive pronouns?
Chapter of Rex Barks. I purchased this book for
all of my third through fifth grade teachers. It begins with a really great chapter about parts of speech, and then it begins diagramming. So,
what was it?
Rex Barks.
Oh, yeah.
I'll take one and pass it around. Okay, so the first step in diagramming is to find your simple subject and your simple predicate. It essentially looks like a headline. So who would our simple subject be in one word? Everybody? Okay. And our simple predicate in one word. What did the cat do? We'll divide them and draw a line. This line goes below. And I also need to cross them out once I put them in the diagram. What kind of cat?
Fat.
So you put a line. Because fat is modifying or describing cat. Let's look at the article. Is it describing cat or the couch?
Cat.
So it goes right there. The cat. All words that describe the subject go under the subject. All words that go under the predicate. Alright. Let's take quietly. Quietly is describing how the cat slept. So it goes under slept, and you write the word quiet. Alright. Now, on the couch is a prepositional phrase. this, the, is describing the couch. So it goes under couch.
Boy with the red hat, does that change anything?
Just the red. No, with is still a preposition.
Preposition. Mm-hmm. Okay.
It may change the meaning, though. It's with
right,
the
red hat.
Right, it
changes
the meaning.
But it's still,
right,
it would still
yeah.
be under, right, describing
yeah,
boy. Right, you're right.
It's a party in here. Do you want to come in?
Thanks.
speak gender.
Adverb.
Oh, I have stuff.
Preposition. Adjective.
Don't want to, you don't have to raise your hand.
Noun.
Verb.
What?
Article. The. So just the two, all the way
yeah.
Three. The.
Yeah.
song. Let's go.
Thank you.
thing and do the right thing.
Yeah.
My thing.
The
and the songs of the birds. If we attempt to make the acquaintance of every little feathered singer we meet, we shall never get to the end of our pleasant task. But we find that some resemble one another in size, shape, color, habits, and song. We associate these together and we call them sparrows. We find others differing essentially from the sparrows but resembling one another. These we call robins. Others, for like reasons, we call bobolinks. With each individual bird, they all belong to a few classes with which we may soon become familiar. It is so with the words of our language. There are many thousands of them, and they all belong to eight classes called parts of speech. We classify birds, their form, color, etc. But we group words into classes called parts of speech with respect to their use in the sentence. We find that many words are names. These we put into one class and we call them nouns. So when I was thinking about transitioning into the Socratic teaching of grammar, I really began to think about kindergarten and first grade and the first time that they're being asked to classify words. And then I was thinking all the way up through third grade when they begin diagramming and what would be of the most importance to them, and I think that would be the questions that we ask them. The first time that they're introduced to a noun, what is the question that we are asking them to point out in a sentence? For example, you're teaching a noun the first time. Your question may be, who is the sentence about? And now this question, who is the sentence about, will carry them through their diagramming and through their education in grammar. And then moving through the parts of speech. Each time it's introduced, we want to think about critically the questions that we are asking and how we, as the educators, can become united and use the same language year after year after year. Bauer, when I've been to several of her lectures and we use her curriculum, she presents grammar in a way that is repetitious. Memorizing definitions, always starting with the definition. And today I'm going to challenge you to actually take one of those lessons and rework it into our Socratic way of teaching. So I really want to focus on the questions first. So I have a quick worksheet that I would love for you to work with the people around you and think, what would those questions be if I wanted my students to arrive at a pronoun, to arrive at a verb? For example, what is the action in this sentence? Yes? Yeah? Thank you.
What questions?
Yeah.
I'm
What do we know about the noun?
Mm-hmm.
So we say, you know, cat select or whatever.
My mom has a cat and she's so great, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think even within the context of the sentence, though, right. They could say, well, let's say the fat cat's left, okay?
Yeah.
So we select, like, well, yeah, but I'm asking about an adjective.
Right.
You know, so what, you know, so kind of use that to show that
right.
These
so
questions can have different levels of.
Absolutely.
You know, where they can get, because they say, oh, yeah, the cat's fat, that's what I'm asking for. That's also what we know about the noun, but that particular thing is the adjective.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think it's trial and error, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe what do we know is more broad, but if I said what kind of cat slept might not.
Yeah,
I mean,
I'm saying, like, depending, if you word it in such a way that you can only get one answer,
yeah.
I mean, that's the answer they'll give for you to get right. But if you word it in a way where they can
absolutely.
Give you more than one answer, maybe that's an opportunity to help them make distinctions.
Yeah.
You know, and see the difference between, like, oh, I can answer this way and that way.
Absolutely. Great thought.
Kind of along those lines, I had a really successful lesson with adjectives, and it works with adverbs too. I put up sentences that had an example of each kind of kind of adjective right there, to all the different questions you could ask. And instead of asking them questions about the adjective itself, I had them label all the other parts of speech in the sentence, because we knew all the other parts of speech. And then I said, what question could we ask where red could be the answer?
Really
and
great.
We ended up coming up with all of the different questions.
Yeah.
And then from there, we took those questions and said, okay, well, what are these words doing? And they were able to decide on calling an adjective a noun describer. And that's what we called it for us.
All about mm-hmm. those synonyms. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's really great. Really powerful. They have such ownership. I love that. Okay, great. So the last piece is I copied some of the Bauer lessons, and you are going to rework it into a Socratic lesson. And then we are going to share them with each other. You're so excited. I can see it. It's oozing out of you. Just share. Okay. Share. There's six in a bunch. And you're all introducing something different. So this whole cluster for the first two rows will be introducing verbs for the first time.
Okay, I think
that was that. Yeah, so if you, the Bauer, I thought about that.
Yeah.
And it's pretty straightforward.
Right.
It's, so you're just going to take it and just go like this.
Oh.
And try and start with questions and lead to the definition. I also made copies of the Socratic lesson if you would like to refer to the question. What is the thing I'm getting at, right? Now you're an expert.
Basically, if you think of it this way, for adults, it's every